Hyperion Audio presents Professional Idiot, a memoir by Stephen Stevo Glover with David Peisner. Read for you by Stevo, Stu Stone, Liam O'Brien, Cassandra Campbell, John Kavarik, Sarah Zimmerman, Wes Dewberry, Mark Holden, Myron Willis, and Jeff Hickson.
Dedication. This book is dedicated to everyone I shit all over for telling me exactly what I needed to hear when I didn't want to hear it. Acknowledgements. Writing this book was more than a little bit scary for me, and I couldn't have done it without plenty of help, love, and support from numerous people. First and foremost, I'd like to thank David Peisner, whose calm and soothing approach to talking me into including controversial information that I wasn't comfortable with won out about 99% of the time. David is an incredible writer, and working with him has been both an honor and a pleasure. I also want to thank Dad, Cindy, Sophie, Jeff Bernstein, Laura Nolan, Beth W., Nick L., Jeff H., Ian Rosenberg, and Cynthia Colonna, Jill Schwartzman, Colin Fox, and everyone at Hyperion, PJ Clapp, Jeff Tremaine, and everyone at Dick House, and everyone else who offered their recollections, opinions, and support. Chapter 1. Hi, this is Steve-O. My friends call me Steve, and now it's time to get into this book. I swear I was born like this. It was March 1996, and I was in jail. The Orange County Correctional Facility in Orlando, to be exact. A couple months earlier, I'd gotten my second DUI in less than a year. I was pulled over for swerving badly while making an illegal U-turn through a red light. I tried to tell the officer I wasn't drunk, just tired. The arrest report actually reads, "Defendant declined roadside sobriety tests, stating he'd prefer to take a nap." Upon my arraignment, I pled guilty and asked the judge if I could just start my 10-day sentence immediately, since I couldn't really afford round-trip bus fare home to South Florida and back. Actually, home is a generous way of describing my living situation at that point. Mom had kicked me out of the house, and not without good cause. I was an irresponsible slob who seemed completely incapable of keeping any sort of job. I was mostly crashing on friends' couches in those days, or when things got really desperate, sleeping in my car, which I'd been driving around with a suspended license and expired tags. I liked to tell people that I was a stuntman, but except for some free t-shirts from a very fledgling Florida-based clothing company called Bizzo, I had nothing really to show for 6 years of videotaping myself skateboarding, jumping from rooftops into shallow pools, and doing whatever else I thought might get people's attention. Also, my front teeth were all busted up from a drunken faceplant I took off a second-story balcony trying to impress some girl at a party more than a year earlier. I hadn't quite gotten around to getting them fixed. Anyone with any sense would have looked at my life at that point and seen nothing but a grand fucking disaster. But sitting there on my bottom bunk in jail, an unemployed, homeless, college dropout with some gnarly-looking front teeth, I was absolutely stoked. I was so sure that it was just a matter of time before the world found out how totally rad I was that I decided what I really needed to do was get a jump start on my memoir. "They call me Steve-O," I wrote. "I'm thinking about switching back to Steve Glover because now I've kind of begun a career and I don't know if I want a nickname when I'm famous." When I'm famous. I love that. As I was writing those opening lines, there was no question in my mind if I was going to be famous. It was just a matter of when. My life at that point may have been an unholy mess that was destined to get much, much messier, but a part of me is envious of that 21-year-old daydreamer. That kid may have had very little going for him, but he knew what he wanted and was absolutely certain he was going to get it. It's still baffling to me how I was capable of such unbelievable enthusiasm and optimism when I had seemingly so little to be enthusiastic or optimistic about. Yet years later, once my dreams had basically become true, I could be such a miserable prick. As I wrote my prison memoir, I'd pass each one of the pages around to some of the other inmates, who, apparently overcome by the stifling boredom in that place, actually read them. It wasn't enough for me to be completely jazzed on how great I thought my life was going to be. I needed other people to know, too. Everyone always says that if you have to go to jail, you should just keep your head down and not draw attention to yourself. But I was totally incapable of following that advice. I needed an audience. It's kind of been that way since the beginning. I was born in London, England on June 13, 1974. At the time, my dad was the marketing director for Pepsi Europe, and I'm told he was in the delivery room dressed in a business suit as my mom was pushing me out. He took some pretty gruesome photos of the delivery and its immediate aftermath. Then, right after I was born and the doctors determined that all was well with mom and me, he rushed off to a meeting. A few days later, when it was time for us to come home from the hospital, mom's friend had to drive us because dad was tied up in more meetings. That kind of set the pattern for my younger years. Dad running around as a rising corporate executive, while mom, my sister Cindy, who is 3 years older than me, and I stayed home. My parents were an odd couple. Dad comes from a family of strivers and achievers. His father, Richard, was born and raised in England, graduated from Oxford, and then went on to get a PhD in history from Harvard. He served in the Canadian Army during World War II, and then spent many years as a university professor in Winnipeg. He died when I was 11, and I remember him mostly as a hard-ass who seemed to disapprove of my antics. When he was around, he made it clear that whatever I was doing, saying, or wearing was unacceptable. In his defense, it probably was, and all the things that rubbed me the wrong way about him back then are things I'm sure would make me respect him now. Dad's mom, Constance, graduated from Vassar and then got a master's degree in English from Mount Holyoke College. This at a time when very few women even went to college. Her family had some money. They were in the paper business. But she and my grandfather lived very frugally. I got to know Grandma Constance pretty well as I grew up. She was an incredibly sweet woman whose kindness and failing memory I totally took advantage of. I don't think she had Alzheimer's, but after my grandfather died, her mind definitely started to go, so it was pretty easy for me to coerce her into doing what I wanted. When I would visit her in British Columbia, I was constantly taking her to go buy me shit. Among other things, I convinced her to get me a stereo with a dual tape deck and my first decent skateboard, a Pal Peralta. She was as good a person as I've ever known, and in retrospect, I feel crappy that when she was suffering from dementia, my main priority was what I could get out of it. Dad's brother and sister both got advanced degrees as well. His sister became the director of two leading art galleries in Canada. His brother was a career naval officer and later a historian. Dad's extended family is also full of academics, and going into the business world made him kind of the black sheep. My mom's family is a whole other story. She came from a long line of alcoholics, addicts, and depressives. Her parents were both born in Canada, and mom grew up in Ontario. I never knew mom's father, Ed, because he blew his brains out when I was a year old, but what I've heard about him doesn't paint a pretty picture. He was a tall, charismatic guy who liked to walk around with a big wad of cash and show off a lot. He had inherited quite a bit of money and owned some car dealerships, but he spent a lot of time hanging out at the horse track, gambling and getting drunk. It's my understanding that he pissed away whatever money he had. Ed was an alcoholic, and apparently a particularly volatile and unpleasant one at that. Mom had been a straight-A student in school and won a scholarship to help with her university expenses, but my grandfather refused to give her any money for tuition, telling her repeatedly that it was a waste of money to send a girl to college. Another story I heard about him is even more disturbing. When my sister Cindy was a baby, Mom took her to visit our grandparents, and my grandfather got into a drunken argument with my mom, during which he apparently pulled out a gun and pointed it at Cindy. It's possible this story has been exaggerated over time, but the police were definitely called, and my grandfather spent a night in jail before the charges were eventually dropped. Not surprisingly, he and Mom had been estranged for a while by the time he killed himself. Mom's mom, Thelma, was also a gnarly alcoholic. I didn't see her that much, but it seemed whenever I did, she was drunk. As she got older, her hands were always beet red from cirrhosis, and she couldn't even sleep through the night without getting up for a sip of something to fend off the withdrawal tremors. At some point, I heard a story about how she got drunk, passed out, and left a cigarette burning, which set fire to the living room of her apartment. I don't remember anyone thinking this was terribly shocking. After my granddad committed suicide, she married a guy named Wayne Howell, who had a long career as a TV announcer with NBC. He was also an alcoholic, so he fit right in with the rest of the dysfunctional family. Not all of my memories of Mom's family are negative. Mom and her sister Janice were pretty close, and I remember them hanging out together and joking around pretty frequently. Around the time I got accepted to Ringling Brothers and Barnum & Bailey Clown College in my 20s, my cousin Neil, Janice's son, was in school to become a mortician. I can remember Mom and Aunt Janice sitting at the kitchen table in Mom's house, laughing about whose son was a bigger loser. The one who was going to be wearing floppy shoes and a big red nose, or the one who'd be embalming dead bodies. They spent hours cracking up about it, and I can't say it really hurt my feelings because, frankly, they were hysterical. I think Mom's family stressed her out, though. There would occasionally be late-night drunken phone calls during which her mom would lash out at her. I don't want to make it sound like Mom's family were just awful people. I know that's not fair. But alcoholism and depression are very real illnesses that many people in her family have struggled with, and they tended to overwhelm just about everything else about them. As Cindy once put it, that family tree, every single branch, is dripping with booze, drugs, gambling, and suicide, going back as far as anyone can remember. My parents both seemed pretty intent on keeping Mom's entire family at arm's length from us while we were growing up. I'm sure the idea was to insulate Cindy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.